for survivors who go into mental health systems. Basically, service users will encounter broad opinions about the cause of their distress, and that's because that's the nature of the business, really, I suppose. We just got it completely wrong. There is no definites here, no absolutes. But it's arbitrary. It will depend on a diagnosis sometimes. And I think maybe we're getting a bit less attached to the diagnosis and more about sort of the management. But still, I think diagnosis has been taken on by lots of other professions now. Beyond the psychiatrist, the psychologist, the nursing profession, even social workers are making diagnoses. And our services are commissioned on diagnoses more and more. And so it depends on the individual's interpretation of that diagnosis as to whether the person's real story, their backstory, you know, they haven't just turned into a schizophrenic overnight after a few bad dreams like Gregor Samsa. Something's happened to them. And then the professional's own explanatory model of the diagnosis will influence then what care they receive. One factor, because there's lots of factors in that, but it's important for professionals to realise that they're bringing their own values, and it's important to find out what the person's own explanatory model is. Because often people I see will never have engaged with the fact that they've been abused or ever link it with their current experiences, so you have to respect that as well. But I think there is movement in this area to start thinking about trauma and childhood abuse as an important factor in some of the conditions and experiences that people are presenting to mental health services. There's John Reed, a psychologist from New Zealand, I'll put up a paper where he's the lead author in a minute, just to show you the kind of what's happening in that area. There's Alice Miller, I think she was a psychoanalyst, do you know? Psychoanalyst, I think she famously gave it up because she thought the psychoanalysis was turning a blind eye to abuse as well. Colin Ross, a psychiatrist in America, trying to develop a trauma model of conditions, you know. And Judith Herman came up with a concept, complex PTSD, because even most people I see have been abused in childhood did not present with the textbook symptoms of PTSD. It's much more complicated, you know. Oh, and that picture is, I suppose, from the old asylums. It's somebody with what's called catatonia, a movement disorder where they lose control of their body and their muscular movements. But also probably a lot to do with the treatment that was initiated in those times, you know, very, very high doses of antipsychotics contributed to that. But I think movement is an important concept. That's what conferences like today are all about, isn't it? So Colin Ross, I mean, I think it's important, you can read this. We can't just pathologise the family, because one of the big stories in psychiatry was the family was pathologised in the 60s by sociologists and social psychologists. And he said, you know, they came up with the term schizophrenogenic mother and the toxic family, but there was a lot of important truth in what they were saying. It's just that I think you've got to have a broader concept of the family. The family for someone who's been abused might not be a mum and dad. It might be the caregivers of, you know, around them. But I think that really is fundamentally represents what a lot of people coming to me, they go crazy trying to understand what's happened to them. They literally, in general parlance, they've gone crazy. They've lost contact with reality because the reality is just appalling and cannot be understood. But we can understand it as professionals because we're not in it with them. We have to take a point outside of them to understand, to help. And I think it's important that we use the evidence that's out there to start influencing professional bodies and, you know, the NHS. It's very powerfully centrally managed now. The clinical work is even very much centrally managed, you know, by a few important characters in the Department of Health. So we need to maybe start influencing those structures as well. So just some, that's a very broad review of the evidence base of sort of schizophrenia and diagnosis and how trauma is an important and really important risk factor in those conditions. And so I urge you to have a look at it, especially if you're in the profession or if you're in the, you do clinical work in mental health services. And these are some of the figures. I mean, that will be no surprise probably to anybody in this audience. But I generally think, you know, the people who come to see me with the level of distress and symptoms they have, there's very, very likely that they've experienced trauma. And I don't sort of discount that until, I never really discount it, I suppose. And I'll talk about that later. And so that those figures, 70% kind of mark, which are probably underestimates as well, they're within the mental health, they're within inpatient wards and outpatient departments. So that's a kind of quite a severe range a severe population. It's the impact that trauma's had on them has become very at the severe end of, or maybe there's other reasons why some people end up in mental health systems and some people end up in prisons. So these are figures from a community sample. Again, I think that would surprise most psychiatrists as well, that the presence of sexual abuse and other trauma is so high in people with a psychosis diagnosis, because that diagnosis is so associated with organic and brain disease and drug use. And these are very high figures. You know, the likelihood that you're 15.5 times more likely to have been sexually abused than somebody. If you've got a diagnosis, get this right. If you've got a diagnosis of psychosis, you're 15 times more likely to have been abused than someone without that diagnosis and without any other mental health condition. And so it's not saying everyone who's been abused develops psychosis, and it's not saying everyone with psychosis has been abused, but there's a very powerful link, and it's a greater link than some of these other conditions, you know. So it needs to be addressed. And it needs to get into the general sort of consciousness of mental health teams, because most people now accept in mental health professionals that marijuana use, especially in teenage years, is linked to psychosis. But the odds ratios, the odds of that link is probably around 11. So this is even stronger, but it hasn't got the influence yet. And this is where I think there's something really missing. The NICE guidelines are now driving everything in mental health care. They're like the Bible of sort of psychiatry and mental health teams. Everything's got to be NICE guidelines nowadays, and they have a really important part to play. But in the schizophrenia and bipolar guidelines, there's scant reference to trauma, because that's been siphoned off into the PTSD guideline. So there needs to be a bit more thinking. And if services did think about it and the commissioners did think about it more intelligently and brought knowledge from, you know, this audience into play more, you could actually improve outcomes, you know. You know, you could save money. That's what they want to do, isn't it? You've got to prove that working in this way will actually save money. Well, if you keep people out of hospital and do less intense interventions, you'll actually save money as well, but you'll help people recover. So some good news, so I'm not going to bash my whole kind of work environment. I can't take credit for this because I've only just recently joined this pilot group in Sheffield. So the Department of Health do have an initiative to improve the experience of survivors in mental health systems by at least getting the staff to ask the question in assessments. What they do then is still, I think, needs massive amounts of work on. But so 63% of the staff who work with patients in mental health care in Sheffield have done the training, so it's a start. It's a big question. I'd like to say maybe it's not just psychiatry, it's not just psychiatrists, you know, it's the whole mental health system. It hasn't engaged this reality yet, and that I think that just reflects society. But that's where movement is starting. And I hope this doesn't kind of offend anyone, but it's a picture that I found to when I was trying to answer that question, what are the barriers? Why aren't my colleagues asking people who present with voices or mood swings or self-harm or, you know, aggression, why aren't they asking them what's happened in their childhood? Why aren't they asking them specifically if they've been traumatised? And I think it's a minefield that people don't want to walk through. The professionals just don't want to walk through it. They think that they're opening up something. That to me looks like the Holocaust, you know. And I think it's that scary. I don't want to go there, you know. But I think I have a bit more faith in my colleagues, you know, as time goes on, that there's more and more, once you start sort of opening it up, they actually believe that this is an important area that's being ignored. So I suppose I kind of use in my day-to-day work, and I try and encourage and support my colleagues as well, because they do most of the hard work, you know, sort of spending hours on end with people who are quite traumatised and distressed. I mean, I have like 30-minute appointments, and you know, I just have a lot of respect really for that patience and empathy that you spend hours with people who are quite traumatised. I don't just sit in my ivory tower though, I go and see people at home, and because I think you've got to go out and see people in their homes to find out what's really going on for them. And people come to psychiatrist's offices and tell you exactly what they think you want to hear. So they're trying to read my mind to tell me what they what will please me sometimes, you know. So I think you've got people in mental health care, you've got to have an underlying appreciation that, you know, if you're in the system, or if you've been referred, even just being referred by a doctor to see a psychiatrist or a nurse or a CBT therapist, you know, to varying degrees, you're in a traumatised state. You don't go and see these people because you're having a really good time and you want someone to share it with. You go and see your mates for that, you know. So they're traumatised, you know. Nobody with these experiences is having a decent time in life. They're overwhelmed. So, but what's traumatised? Well, the person's been traumatised often. More often than not, probably when you get to more severe sort of mental health problems, they've been traumatised as children in various ways. But, you know, as a professional, as a medical professional,